Let's chat to some of these headlines now with Johnson Chukwu, the CEO at Kari Asset Management. Sir, good evening to you and welcome to the program. We appreciate your time.
Good evening, boss, and a happy new year.
Thank you so much. It's good to see you on the other side of 2020. So let's start with the big story because the stock market is called the home of capitalism. For whatever we discuss, that's where it all boils down to. So the formation of three new companies, three new CEOs, the letter we got today that the claim panel has also been set up. It looks like Oscar Onyema and the rest of his team are fast-tracking this entire process. What's your outlook on this process?
For me, it's actually most expensive. Because if you look at when we started the demutualization process almost more than 10 years ago, and we are now seeing a lot of pressure. At some point between 2015 and 2017, it went into a doldrum. But by 2017, they reactivated it. And we've seen a lot of activities between 2019 and 2020 in respect to the demutualization. So the board of Nigeria Stock Exchange has already met and approved the formation of those four companies, three companies plus the holding company, and the MDs have just been appointed, as you rightly pointed out. And then for the claims, then we have now a board that will also supervise the claims management. So we are going to see, likely at this speed, we are likely going to see the completion of the mutualization process sooner than most people expected.
Do you think we have sensitized the investors community enough? The local retail investors about this whole demutualization program?
What I would say is that we are getting to that level of awareness. In the first place, the dealers who are going to be shareholders and ordinary members have been fully sensitized. The Kari Asset is one of the dealers. And we're entitled, based on the scheme of arrangement, to about 6,007,000 shares, which all the 255 dealing members are entitled to. Then the non-dealing members are going to be entitled to about 2.4 million shares each. And if you consider that between the dealing members and non-dealing members, you have more than 400 investors or shareholders that will be automatic shareholders of the demutualized Nigerian Exchange Group PLC. Again, as for the retail investors who will eventually buy shares, I want to believe that when the demutualization is completed and the shares are transferred to the dealing members and non-dealing members who will be in position to sell those shares, a lot more awareness will be created. As we are discussing them, we are also creating awareness. We have the four companies, three of them have their CEOs. Oscar Onyema is now the group chief executive of Nigerian Exchange Group PLC. We have the Nigerian Exchange Limited, which will be the securities trade dealing company, has its MD appointed. We have the MD of Nigerian Exchange Regulation Limited, MD appointed. The one that we don't have the MD appointed is the real estate arm of the subsidiaries. So this is also creating awareness. The key thing is that the Nigeria Stock Exchange has a platform for creating awareness on the demutualization process.
So within the stockbroking community, it looks like you folks are getting this moved on as smoothly as since March last year when those special meetings were held to ratify those the current move, and it looks like it's already in motion. But let's get into the wider Maersk Financial Services. In the industry, we're seeing the rise of women into top CEO positions. We have a female CEO in Unity Bank, then we have a top in the C-suit, also in First Bank. Now we have in Fidelity Bank as well. Why is this happening? Why this change of guards?
What I think is that if you look at the Nigerian social environment, you will observe that the barriers in terms of gender inequality is narrowing. Narrowing or closing, particularly in the southern part of the country. Some of the cultural barriers that held back women are gradually being broken down. If you look at beyond, apart from the financial services industry, where you have female lending in Fidelity Bank, NECA. You have a female MD now, or acting MD in FCMB. You just reminded me of the female MD in Unity Bank. And if you go to almost all the banks, you have women in their C-suite among the chief executives. You also have a female MD, the first female MD, as the MD of Cabre. As you know, Yimika Adebo is the MD of Cabre, the first female MD in Cabre's history in Nigeria. So you recognize that we are seeing a lot of a rise of females within the C-suite of Nigerian corporate society. Because, like I said earlier, we are gradually breaking down those, what they call the glass ceilings that held women back in their career progression, particularly in the southern part of the country where cultural barriers and religious barriers have been largely broken down.
Alice, we've had about three director generals of the SEC as women as well, and even within the stockbroking community, I'm sure. Lotus Capital is also headed by a woman. So it looks like the women are here.
In fact, to add to that, Cowley Securities Limited is also headed by a woman.
Oh, that's the disclosure. We appreciate that. That's very interesting. So it looks like this is the season. I noticed also that the new stock exchange structure, the mutualized exchange, has Tinu Adeyewo as the CEO as well as the CEO of the Nigeria Exchange Regulation. So that means it's also that a lot of things are happening on Broad Street. Well, let's welcome the women into the fold. So, Access Bank, talking about consolidation now, announced the completion of its Zambian unit of a Kavumont Bank. Would you like to see more of this, Frontier Africa's consolidation by Nigerian banks?
Interestingly, we saw that immediately after the consolidation of the Nigerian banking system. But there was a pullback because some of them did not do well in this environment. But in the case of Access Bank, they have a unique competence, and that competence, this is an institution that has grown massively through inorganic growth, through acquisition. So one could say that Access Bank has actually honed their competencies in terms of acquisition. And that's why if you look at Access Bank's acquisition have been successful, not just outside the country, they've also seen strong acquisition in Nigeria. Remember that Access Bank acquired Intercontinental Bank and subsequently acquired Diamond Bank, and before it became what it is today as one of the top five banks in the country. And that approach is obviously what they adopted in acquiring Kavumont Bank in Zambia. So for me, one would expect that other Nigerian banks that want to expand by through inorganic growth can learn from what Access Bank is doing. But banks have their unique strategies. It may not be the same approach by other banks. Some may want to grow organically. A bank like GT Bank has insisted on growing organically over the years. But we should expect that the consolidation of the financial system in Africa will continue, whether it's Access Bank that will keep acquiring or other Nigerian banks will join them. But even if we don't, we're going to see South African banks try to expand in other African countries through acquisition, particularly as Africa now adopt the African Continental Free Trade Agreement, where the African economy is going to be a global, a single economy.
A quick one, Johnson, about the unclaimed dividend. The federal government has finally laid its hands on this unclaimed dividend. What's your reaction to this? What's the talk right now on Market Street about this?
You know, Boston, for me, I've looked at the pros and cons of it. Let me start from the cons, which are the concerns that people have raising, that would the federal government have the structure to pay back those dividend when the owners claim them or make demands for them. The good thing at the center, the federal government is assessing these funds through a trust fund that was managed by the Debt Management Office. And you know, DMO is the one managing the federal government debt obligations to the country. So I want to believe that since DMO have gotten to the level where they are managing both the local currency debt and foreign currency debt, it wouldn't be so difficult for them to manage about 154.8 billion naira of unclaimed dividends. I don't think that's too much if you consider how much they are currently managing. The good side of it is that these dividends or claim dividend will now be entitled to interest income, unlike what we currently have today, where the benefits only accrues to those bank, company that issued those dividends. Currently, any dividend that is beyond 6 years will now be transferred to DMO and borrowed by the federal government, for which they pay interest on it. So the unclaimed dividend will now have the benefit of higher income, higher value when you make claims on them.
How should investors deal in the market in matters such as sensitive as that of the FCMB currently?
Interestingly, I've avoided discussing the FCMB issue privately. But since you have brought it up, you saw how investors reacted on Monday to FCMB shares, which I think may have forced the hands of the board to ask the MD to go on compulsory leave. The key thing we have to recognize is that public institutions should also be custodians of ethical values. And ethical values go beyond legal obligations. It's at the level of moral issues. And the issues at stake impinge on the moral values of Nigerians, which was why people reacted so violently on the shares of FCMB. So for me, it should be a lesson for other corporate organizations. We all need to go and rewrite our ethical standards. And ensure that we tighten it and ensure that it encompasses issues that are morally reprehensive to the society.
Johnson Chukwu, let's leave it there for today. Thank you for your time and do have a pleasant weekend. Johnson Chukwu, CEO at Cari Asset Management. Thank you so much. I will see you some next time. Let's.